For all of my years on Wall Street, the heat of the moment is usually centered somewhere down the trading floor where there was a big, thick stack, almost like a book, of pink sheets. And they were the securities that were unregulated, securities that were frontier economy, less than over-the-counter as well. One B. Ritholtz, Barry Ritholtz, Bloomberg Opinion columnist, takes great issue with David Einhorn's comments with Greenlight. David Einhorn's comments that the pink sheets are a metaphor for this great economy in these unregulated times. Barry, you're at 30,000 feet. Einhorn's with the pink sheets. How far apart are you?
I don't think we're apart. I think, and let me preface my remarks by saying I'm a giant fan of Einhorn's work, and he was one of the first people who identified Lehman Brothers as technically insolvent. So I take everything he says very seriously, but he's just wrong across the board about all of the things he suggests regarding this idiotic $100 million deli. Let me start granular and say in 2015, I was looking for disconfirming evidence. We all tend to go out and look for things that confirm our belief, but I was bullish and said, let me find something that might make me less bullish. And I found similarly on the pink sheets, $100 million grilled cheese food truck. To be fair, they owned four trucks, not just one. But then again, those are depreciating assets. They didn't own the land underneath the way the deli does. And it proved exactly nothing. There are always garbage companies on the pink sheets that have crazy valuations. P.S. GRLD was the stock symbol for that company. They stopped trading. I wrote that in 2015. They stopped trading in 2019 and closed last year. So to draw a conclusion from an outlier is just bad rhetoric.
But Barry, there is a question. How do we know when something is idiosyncratic, and we made that a drinking game, so go ahead, versus a symptom of a broader problem?
That's a fantastic question. And the answer is don't show me one outlier. I was in a dinner some time ago when people were debating a big point, and I always cringe whenever someone says, well, my aunt's mailman tells the story. Just stop. This is an anecdote. A single example is an anecdote. Data is not, anecdote is not the singular of data. Data is not the plural of anecdote. When you could say, hey, relative to all these other factors, this suggests that the market is wildly overvalued, that's a very different argument than pointing to a single company and saying, hey, look how ridiculous this is. There are always ridiculous companies out there. And in 2015, you know, since I wrote that, the market has doubled.
Right.
And so you can't just look at a single thing. P.S., I was kind of shocked to see the claim. Well, this is proof that the, you know, the SEC and the regulators aren't paying attention. By definition, if it's on the pink sheets, no disclosures, no regulation, no accounting, no GAAP. Nothing. That's why the pink sheets are filled with shell companies and bankrupt companies. If there's a piece of garbage company that should be worthless, it's going to be there. And they're all too small for anybody to arbitrage them back to reality.
Barry, I take your point, and I think that it is a well-taken point, especially at a time when we see so much money flooding into the financial system. And we're talking about a deli that was valued at its peak at $113 million and trying to use that as an example representing the entirety of a trillion, multi-trillion dollar financial system would be remiss. At the same time, there are many instances of this. I was looking at a story this morning of Dogecoin, which was started as satire, a satire cryptocurrency.
Right.
It now has a bigger market capitalization than either Ford or Kraft of $50 billion. This is, by definition, started as satire, as a joke. I mean, at what point are there enough of these stories to start ringing bells?
So Rob Arnott of Research Affiliates put out a very interesting, insightful piece on EVs, but you can apply the same thinking to cryptos. And he references a professor at Caltech named Brad Cornell, who uses the phrase, quote, big market delusions. And what that means is when a sector is priced as if every member of that group is going to be the outsized winner. And he uses electric vehicles as an example. You can have Tesla and Lucid and NIO and the two dozen startups plus all of the internal combustion incumbents from Volkswagen to Ford to GM to Toyota. You can't have all of them be the majority market share. So you get this collective delusion.
Right.
Eventually, the losers fall out, and you're left with a handful of winners. That happened with computers, and it happened with television, radio. It happens with fiber optics. Every new technology leads to that. We will probably see something very similar to that in crypto, with maybe it's Ethereum and Bitcoin, or maybe it's some combination, and the rest of these become worthless. But right now, we're dealing with that term, big market delusion, when the whole sector is ridiculous, and they're priced as if they're all winners, when we know there'll be one or two winners.